We've been watching a movie, a modern day retelling of the book of Hosea before each one of these messages. And for those of you who may be new here, may be wondering what's going on in that one, and we'll get just a little bit to that in a minute. But this sermon series is the book of Hosea, and it's really called a story pursued by God. That's what the Hosea story is all about. And I think some of us realize God's pursuing us, but we're a little confused sometimes about why. It reminds me of a story when I was in my first youth ministry in a few miles up the road here. I was a young rookie. I wasn't very wise. I was kind of wet behind the ears, so to speak, and I didn't really make a lot of good decisions. When I first came to this church, I was informed that there was this little competition that went on every year where the youth minister and the youth group would have an opportunity to teepee the youth coaches' houses, right? It was a lot of fun. The youth coaches got in on it. We went to one of those houses, and literally one of the ladies hid underneath the porch, and she sprayed us with water hose. It was just a good, fun competition, teepee. And if you're not familiar with those of you who never did anything like that, it's throwing toilet paper on trees and making a big mess, you know? And so we did that to several of the youth coaches' houses. But I was, well, let's just say I was an idiot. And I believed one of the youth kids who told me that Bob Broughton, Mr. Broughton, one of the high school teachers, also enjoyed being in on this game. And he was a good kid, so I believed him, and I trusted him. Sure enough, we packed up the car. We drove out in the middle of the country to where Mr. Broughton's house was. We parked the car down the road, and then we hiked down there, totally armed with all of our toilet paper. You know, the cheap stuff. You don't throw away the expensive stuff. All the cheap stuff. And so we went to the house, and we began to do it. And the kids were all excited because they're finally going to get Mr. Broughton. But little did I realize Mr. Broughton really was not in on the game. In fact, he comes out of his house, the porch light comes on, he comes out, shotgun in hand, ready to shoot us. And he chases us, and we're running as hard as we can, being pursued by an angry man, ready to put some shot in our hind end. And we get to the getaway car, and we drive off. And so finally, we're gone from there, and I'm thankful. You know, we were kind of in camouflage and all that, so he didn't recognize us. We're in good shape, right? I mean, he doesn't know who did this. So we go on with life a little bit. But I don't know if you know a lot about high school boys, but they had to go brag about it at school, right? And so Mr. Broughton heard about them bragging about it, and Bob Broughton called my boss, the senior minister of the church. And so I'm away one day, just enjoying a day off, and I get a call, and he says, "You've got to come here now." And then I'm thinking, oh no, I'm in big trouble. And he didn't tell me what it was about. So I get back to the church office, and he is just laying into me, and he says he's got this call for, and what a bad representation this is for the church and for me and all that. So he takes me to Mr. Broughton's house to apologize and to clean up all the teepee, all the toilet paper from his trees. Lesson learned, right? But I have a feeling that some of you can relate, at least in some sense, to God. You think of God chasing you like Mr. Broughton was chasing us, only he's not chasing you for good reasons. You think he's chasing you to pay you back for all the wrong you do. He's pursuing you to punish you. He's pursuing you to get what you deserve. He is angry, and he's chasing you with all the weapons at his disposal. And when he catches you, there will be hell to pay. But what we've learned through the book of Hosea, what is true in the gospel that's clearer than ever, is that God is pursuing you. But he isn't pursuing you to make you pay what you owe. He isn't pursuing you out of anger and revenge. He is pursuing you because he loves you and he wants to save you. He wants a relationship with you. He desires to give you life and life to its fullest. And that's why he's after you. And so the moral of the series has really been stop running. Stop running. That's what we've been learning. In fact, as we've looked through this series, let me give you a little context for the book of Hosea in case you're brand new or jumping in, you've been away for a while. The book of Hosea is an Old Testament book, and all throughout the Old Testament times, God's people, the people of Israel, actually had divided into two kingdoms, the southern kingdom of Judah, the upper kingdom of Israel. They had both wandered from God time and time again. God had brought his people out of slavery, out of bondage. He rescued them. He saved them. He brought them manna from heaven. He provided for them. He loved them, and he cared for them. And as soon as he would get them out of the mess, what would they do? They would turn and go straight back to what got them there. They would go straight back. They would resist God, and they would instead follow the idols of this world. They would worship the things of this world. They were doing a lot of Baal worship, which is the false god of the enemy's people. And that's what we see. So what God would do during this time is he would send a prophet, somebody he had chosen to be the preacher, the proclaimer, to bring the message of repentance, to bring the message, bringing them back, encouraging them to come back to where they honored God. And Hosea is one of those. In fact, he's the first of what we call the minor prophets. Not minor because it's not important, but minor because it's a shorter book than some of the other books. And so he's a minor prophet, and Hosea is the first one. And so God sends Hosea to bring a message. But there's a little bit of a unique twist to his calling here. His calling in ministry, actually, Hosea probably had the worst ministry assignment in the history of ministry assignments. God says, listen, I don't just want you to go proclaim the message and tell them to come back to me. I want you to do something that's going to illustrate what's happened. The fact that they've turned their backs on me, that they've hurt me, that they've cheated on me, but yet I still love them anyway. He tells Hosea to marry a prostitute. To go marry a prostitute. Someone that he knows is going to be unfaithful. That's what he tells him to do. And he says, this is going to be an illustration. She's going to hurt you. She's going to cheat on you. But you're going to keep loving her. You're going to stay faithful to her no matter how unfaithful she is to you. And that will show my people what I have done for them. And that's exactly what Hosea does. He marries a prostitute by the name of Gomer. And after a short time, yes, she is unfaithful. In fact, they start having children, and several of those children are not his. And then she starts wandering. And then she takes off with another man, and Hosea was always there to welcome her back. And then last week we see that she ran off with another lover, and apparently he gets tired of her and kicks her out or sells her or whatever. She's ended up not just back in prostitution, but she's actually a sex slave. She's on the auction block to be sold to the highest bidder. And Hosea does what God asks, and he goes. And he leverages money he doesn't even have to purchase her back and to gain her freedom. And he welcomes her back. And it's a beautiful love story. Not only because of Hosea and Gomer, but because of God and the Israelites, and because of God and us. Because you see, it's not just the story of Hosea and Gomer, and it's not just the story of God and the Israelites. It's the story of us as well, God and his people today. Because we too are Gomers. We have wandered away. We've chased the idols of this world, and Jesus paid the ransom to get us back. Gomer's story parallels ours. We settle so often for cheap substitutes, and we run for the idols of this world. Because I want you to understand something. Idol worship isn't just, you say, well, I've never worshipped a statue. Idol worship isn't worshiping little statues or golden calves. Idol worship's more than that. I like what Pastor Tim Keller says. He says, what is an idol? It's anything more important to you than God. Anything that absorbs your heart and imagination more than God. Anything you seek to give you what only God can give. So it can be money, it can be success, it can be work, it can be fame, it can be significance, it can be worldly pleasures, it can even be your children. Or even church. Because good things, when they become God things, are idols, and they're wrong. And so we do this time and time again. And so Hosea gives us a picture here of spiritual adultery. See, that's the primary picture and illustration of sin in the Bible. Because adultery is this picture of someone who's been betrayed, been wronged, heart ripped out. And that's the way God feels. That's what happens when we chase the wrong things instead of him. And the truth is, that's what all sin leads back to. All sin, the root of all sin, is putting something in God's place that shouldn't be there. For example, if you're living a sexual life of immorality, and every week we have people come who live together outside of marriage and are involved in that, I want you to know that your sin is not really ultimately primarily a sexual sin. It's not trusting God's way and not doing it His way. You see, it's really a refusal to trust God and be patient with your future and His time. Or if you're stressed and really down and out and you turn to alcohol or you turn to drugs or you turn to shopping, your primary source of sin is not drunkenness or addiction or excessive spending. It's the fact that you're turning to something else besides God to fulfill your life. Or if your finances, if you're looking to financial security as your idol, as your way to put you up, then it's you're not trusting God with your future. That's why so often the Bible makes a big deal out of giving your first fruits back to God, because that says, I trust you, God. I know that you will provide. And so anytime we put something in the rightful place that God belongs, we are committing spiritual adultery. Yet even though we do that, He keeps chasing us. Like Hosea in the story, like God to the Israelites, He keeps pursuing us in love because He's got something far greater in mind for us. We are worth so much to Him that He gave up so much for us. I don't know if you noticed this last week in the news, but a painting by Leonardo da Vinci sold for $450 million. $450 million, a painting sold. Wasn't even that good, really, but it sold for $450 million. Now, I know what you're saying. You're saying, there's no painting worth $450 million. That painting is not worth $450 million. And I'm going to argue with you and tell you it is. You know why that painting is worth $450 million? Because somebody was willing to pay $450 million. You see, the value of something is actually determined by what someone is willing to pay for it. Now, what does that say about you? That God was willing to send His one and only Son to die in your place, to break His body, to shed His blood in your place, that God gave His one and only Son not to be served, but to serve and to give His life as a ransom for many, to save us, to buy us back, to redeem us. That should tell you how much you're worth to God. You're worth everything to Him. And throughout this series, we've been reminded of that, the story of being pursued. And the rest of the book of Hosea actually addresses not much about Gomer and Hosea's story as it does God and Israel's story. And today, what I want you to see is that while we're pursued by God, what we are pursued for is we are pursued to become. To become something far greater than you ever imagined. A child of God. We are pursued to become. You are to become what God always intended you to be. So if you have a Bible and an electronic device, open up to Hosea chapter 6. Hosea chapter 6. It'll be page 534 in the church Bible. And we're going to read the first six verses of this chapter. And I just want you to get a little glimpse of something here that's going to help us see how we become what God wants us to become in Hosea chapter 6. Now, in the series here, you might notice that we went from 3 to 6. In chapters 4 and 5, the Israelites wander again and God sends His indictment. In fact, the indictment is even more towards the leaders of His people here, and He really throws it down. And then it gets to this passage here, and we're going to see something really special happen here. We're going to see that the Christian life is really a process. I don't know if you realize that or not. Salvation is instantaneous. It's momentaneous. The moment you accept Jesus Christ, you submit your life to Him, you are saved. But salvation is different than the process of growing in Christ, what we would call sanctification, which means being growing more holy, more like Jesus. That is a lifelong process that begins at salvation and ends when Jesus comes back. And so it's going to happen your entire life. And the Bible says, He who's begun a good work in you is faithful to stick with it until it's complete, basically. And so we're a process, and we're not what we want to be, but we're not where we were either. I like what this quote from John Newton, the guy that wrote Amazing Grace. Listen to this quote. I am not what I ought to be. I'm not what I want to be. I'm not what I hope to be, but still, I'm not what I used to be. And it's by grace, the grace of God, that I am what I am. That's a pretty good description, isn't it, of all of us. And so we see this description, and we get over here to chapter 6, and listen to what Hosea says. Come, let us return to the Lord. He has torn us to pieces, now he will heal us. He has injured us, now he will bandage our wounds. In just a short time, he will restore us, so that we may live in his presence. Oh, that we might know the Lord. Let us press on to know him. He will respond to us as surely as the arrival of dawn or the coming of the rains in early spring. Oh, Israel and Judah, he's addressing both kingdoms here. What should I do with you? Asked the Lord. For your love vanishes like the morning mist and disappears like the dew in the sunlight. I sent my prophets to cut you to pieces, to slaughter you with my words, with judgments as inescapable as light. I want you to show love, not offer sacrifices. I want you to know me more than I want burnt offerings. I want you to know me more than burnt offerings. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your word, and may you speak to us with your word how you see fit today, and may we leave here more like you. In Jesus' name, amen. I mentioned that the Christian life, the process is a process that starts at salvation and it goes to the end. In fact, we are totally being made new all the time. And in Corinthians, Paul says to the church that he who belongs to Christ is a new person. The old is gone, the new has come. But there is a process that happens here. And let's face it, those of us who gather on both campuses, there are many of us who here who really want this, right? I mean, we want to be more like Christ. We don't just want to be an average Christian. We want to grow more like him. We just either don't have the inner strength to do it, or we just don't want to do what it takes, or we just don't know how to do it. We're running from God. And so God wants us to understand it's not about running for him either, but it's about resting in his grace and returning to him. And so what I want us to see here is some things from this first six verses, this chapter, that can help us become what God wants us to become. The first thing I want us to see is if you want to become what God wants you to become, you got to return to God. You got to return to God. You see, God pursues us and he loves us, but he will not force us. He wants us to return to him. And in the first verse it says, come, let us return to the Lord. God is calling his people back. So many times in their times of trouble, they'll turn to God, but then when things go well, they'll wander from God. And I wonder if that's not a description of so many of us in these rooms here today on both campuses. We go in spurts. We serve him for a while and things are going good, and then we'll fall off the spiritual wagon, so to speak. And we'll be in the wilderness again. And then we'll get it straight for a while, and then we'll wonder again. And we'll get it straight for a while, and we'll wonder again. And then I wonder how many people here that are different than that. Maybe they just treat Sundays like this spiritual shot that they get, this spiritual injection. And they really don't plan on living any different Monday through Saturday. It's just about coming and being inspired and being lifted up through worship and then going out. And I want to tell you, under both of those scenarios, if we treat grace that cheaply, if we live life that way, we are quenching the Spirit of God in our life. Hosea says, return to God, and it's a picture of repentance. In fact, God says, I break them in order to get them to this point. He's torn them to pieces so that he can heal them. He's injured them so that he can bandage their wounds. He had to break them down before he could get them back up. I'm thinking of the movie Hoosiers. I don't know if anybody's watched the movie Hoosiers, where the part played by Gene Hackman, Coach Normandale, he comes into this new town, he has this team, and this team's not very good, and he knows if he's going to get them anywhere, he's got to break them down to next to nothing. And so the first part of the season is breaking them down and really getting them to where they truly trust in his system and depend on him. And then all of a sudden, they can start building them up. And as you know, the rest of the story, they went on to win the state championship. And that's a picture of what God has done to the Israelites here. He breaks them down, or he allows them to be broke down, to go through pain even, in order that they may come to repentance and grow through the pain. Sometimes God uses the pain in our life. So maybe you need to be asking the question, if you're going through pain today, what can God, how can God use your pain to make you more like He wants you to be? What do you need to turn back to Him? You see, the Bible gives a true picture of repentance here. Jesus said, I didn't come to call a righteousness, but sinners to repentance. I came to call sinners to repentance so this new life could begin. Even when Jesus addressed the woman who was caught in adultery and He loved on her, He said, I'm not here, we're not here to judge you. Nobody's here to judge you. But He didn't leave her where she was. He told her to go and leave her life of sin. Repent. Now the word repentance simply means to change direction. It's about face. You're going the wrong way down the road and you turn around and go the right way. And it's more than just feeling guilty. It's this conviction that says, I've sinned against God and others. It's contrition. I'm contrite. I'm sorry. My heart's broken for what I've done. And then it's change. It's an about face, a change of mind, a change of spirit, a change in behavior. It's truly repentant. It doesn't mean that we'll never sin, but it means that we should strive not to by His power. We shouldn't intend to. We shouldn't plan on leaving here and continuing whatever sin we're doing. We preach grace around here, and we love to preach grace, and this is a grace place. And I want you to know, if you come in here and you're a sinner, God wants you to come just as you are, and He will change you and won't let you leave just as you came. But what I'm also here to tell you is, too often times, in an effort not to scare people off, we will shout grace and we will whisper repentance. But I want you to know, there's nowhere in the Bible where repentance is separated from the forgiveness of God. We must be a people who repent, who turn to God and strive to follow after God. And we will never be sinless. But the longer we follow after Him, the more He will help us be sinless and sinless and sinless. And we'll look more like Him. So if you come in here to worship today and you say, God, I love You, but you don't intend on changing the way you live the rest of the week, then I want you to know you're quenching the Spirit of God in your life, and it's time to really repent. You want to see God work in your life? Repent. Come to Him. The second thing I see, though, is that if we really want to be the God, be the person that God wants us to become, we need to live in His presence. We need to live in His presence daily. Hosea says in verse 3, oh, that we might know the Lord. Let us press on to know Him. Let us press on to know Him. I get a picture of, let us strive to know Him. Let us seek after Him. He's the one that sought after us to save us. Now let's seek after Him to be more around Him. I don't know about you, but if I got someone I want to learn from, I want to be around them as much as possible. And that's the way we should want to be with the Lord. We press on to know Him. We want to grow spiritually in His presence. And you cannot do that by coming once a week or coming a couple times a month to worship services. That takes a daily relationship with God. And that takes a lot of things. If you want to have a daily relationship with God, then you probably ought to have a daily prayer life. It's hard, I know. It's not easy. I'm not the best at it. But I want to tell you, God is waiting for you to speak to Him, to talk to Him. He wants to hear from you. He may know your innermost thoughts, but He still wants to hear from you. He loves, as a father and a mother loves to hear from their kids, as a grandparent loves to hear from their kids, God desires to hear from us. And when we hear from us, there's a connection that changes us so much. We also need to read His Word. Set aside time to read His Word. If you want to grow in your walk with Him, you got to be in His Word. There's a Bible scripture from the Old Testament that said that we hide these words in our heart that we may not sin against God. There's other scriptures that talk about just feeding on the Word of God, that we want the Word of God in us, that we pick up a Bible and we start reading. And maybe you do that by just reading a book of the Bible, or maybe you follow one of the plans that's outlined on our app or somewhere, or maybe you get in a Bible study or a community group, or you listen the Bible on audio as you're driving down the road, or you subscribe to sermon podcasts where you hear the Word of God proclaimed. I don't know what you need to do, but I know that we need to be in the Word of God, and the more we're in the Word of God, the more we know the God of the Word, and the more He can do in our lives. And He's promised it will not return void. He says to know Me, to press on to know Me. Another way we walk in His presence is just by surrounding ourselves with believers, gathering for worship, gathering for community groups, making worship a high priority where we don't just miss for every little thing. We try to be there the best we can. We make it a big deal if we have to leave. Accountability partners and care groups and CR and things of that nature. Those are all things that are available to help you in your walk with God, to sing worship songs, to play worship music, to gather together with people and have conversations, to talk with people about the Word of God. Those things all play a better part in our worship, in our walking in God's presence. Now, I want you to know something. I'm not one of these guys who, I mean, I love good movies and I love even secular music, and I will always be that way, so I can relate to this culture, and I'm not telling you to get rid of all those things, but I am telling you to understand that what you put in is ultimately what comes out. It's a spiritual law of nature that you can't do anything about, but you can change what goes in. Make it about God. The Bible says, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let God change the way you think. Live in His presence. Live in His presence by doing His will. James says, don't be just be hearers of the word, be doers of the word. So we return and repent, and we live in His presence. And thirdly, we fully give ourselves to God. We fully lay our lives down to God. Verse 6 says, I want you to show love, not sacrifices. I want you to know me more than burnt offerings. Now, I want you to understand something. In the Old Testament, it was a commandment to sacrifice. It was a commandment to bring those burnt offerings. So God isn't saying through Hosea, don't do those things. He's saying, what I desire more is not you to do those meaningless actions if your heart's not in it. He's saying, I want you. I don't want your outward actions alone. I want you. And if I have you, I know the outward actions will follow. He wants us. And so basically through Hosea, God's saying, I desire your actions more than your sacrifice. Your heart more than your emotions, or else it's just a religious ritual that means absolutely nothing. God wants you. He wants you to fully give yourself to Him. Now that involves a word that we aren't often associated with positive things. It's the word surrender. When we think of surrender, we think of it in the negative terms, but I want you to know, until you surrender truly to God, you surrender, you give up, you wave the white flag of your life and say, God, I am yours. You will not walk in what He means for you to be. The reality is there are churches all over the world this weekend who are full of people who want God to help them. They want God for guidance. They want God for counseling. They want God for favors, but they don't want to surrender. Because surrendering means that not one part of my life is off limits to God. I will give Him whatever He asks. We won't say, Lord, I will give you this, but not this. I want to keep this. Lord, I'm going to straighten up and clean my life in this way, but I'm going to keep doing this. See, surrender means we truly repent. We seek God, and we lay our lives down and say, here I am, Lord. I'm yours. Here I am. Now, if you're going to do these things, I just want to give you a couple warnings. First of all, you're going to have to think progress, not perfection. When we're striving to become what God wants us to become, sometimes it can become about outward behavior, and we can mess up, and when we mess up, God says, keep going, and Satan says, see, I told you you couldn't do it. You might as well go back to your old life. But we need to think progress, not perfection. Progress means growth. It means that next year at this time, you should be farther along than you are this year. You shouldn't be satisfied to stay where you're at in your walk. But it doesn't mean you're going to be perfect. It doesn't mean you're not going to fall short of God's glory. I fall short every day, and you will as well. So it's progress, not perfection. Another word of advice is don't think you can just try harder. You got to have it on God's power, not your power. See, it's the power of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 says we fight with weapons of divine power. It's not external weapons. When you are facing temptation, when you are facing those things, there's a spiritual battle that goes on, and you can't be strong enough to do it on your own. You got to trust in His power. You got to submit to Him and lean into His power and watch Him go to work. The Bible says that this in Ephesians chapter 1, how incredibly great is His power to help those who believe in Him. How incredible is His power to help those who believe in Him. It is the same mighty power that brought Christ from the dead. Do you get that, church? The same power is in you if you've repented and submitted and laid your life to Him. The same power is in you that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. And it's not about trying harder. It's about living in Him and watching Him work in you. And when you do, you will be amazed, because He who has begun a good work in you will be faithful until it's completed. And God wants you to become far more than an average Christian. God wants you to become far more than somebody who checks evangelical on the poll. God wants you to become far more than somebody who votes the right way and puts the right bumper sticker on their car and watches all the right movies. God wants you to become somebody who is used every day by Him to draw people to Him, in order that when we get to heaven, others are there because we introduced Him to Jesus. I don't know how many of you know the story of Chuck Colson. Chuck Colson died several years ago, but Chuck Colson died as being one of the most celebrated and wonderful apologists for Christianity and guys who spoke in the movement. But his story started out quite ugly. He was in the Nixon administration, and he was known as Nixon's hitman. He was dirty and behind the scenes did a lot of unsavory things, and actually ended up going to prison for the Watergate scandal. He was humiliated, down on his life, and he was introduced to Jesus Christ while in prison. Not the Jesus he thought he knew, but the real Jesus, the one to get a hold of his life and help him become far more than he ever dreamed. Chuck Colson followed Jesus Christ all the way out the doors of that prison, and he kept following Christ, and he started Prison Ministry Fellowship, which witnesses to literally thousands of inmates around the world and introduces them to Jesus Christ and helps them grow in their walk with Christ. And he didn't stop there. He started many other ministry organizations like Breakpoint and those things where he encouraged and taught about Jesus Christ, and he spoke all across the country. And I want you to know there are literally thousands of people, both prisoners and their families and otherwise, who know Jesus Christ because of what God did in Chuck Colson's life. He was pursued to become something far greater than he ever could have asked or imagined. And so are you. So are you. So stop running. Stop running. And come to God. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your church. Thank you for pursuing us. We would have wanted nothing to do with you on our own, but you just kept wooing us. You kept loving us. You kept chasing us. And Lord, we finally stopped. And we put the ring on. And Lord, maybe there's someone here today who's never done that and they need to put the ring on. And I picture baptism much in that way. It's a chance to repent of sins, to confess before others, and to die to self and be raised with you. And maybe there's someone here who needs to do that for the very first time today, to just trust in you as Lord and Savior. Lord, there's others who have been Christians a long time, but it's just really been a name thing. Oh, they live a decent life and they don't do a lot of bad things, but Lord, they're not really becoming what you want them to become. They're not walking. They're not repenting. They're not surrendering in you. Maybe today is their day to come back. And may they do that. And maybe there's many, maybe all of us, that needs to realize that you went to a great cost to buy us back. And you didn't buy us back to do nothing, to just live comfortably. You bought us back because you wanted to be with us and you want to use us to love you and love people and change the world. May we realize that today. Through Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
In a noble, sweet song, I'll sing.